board's recommendation, then perhaps we can at least proceed on an informal basis to review your subdivision plan. Once the ordinance has been changed, then we will be prepared and could be prepared to immediately go to public hearing process, because we will need a new public hearing, given the nature of the changes to the plan, and start the subdivision review process at that point. So with your comments to that, Mr. Taylor, we will proceed.
With the understanding that this process represents merely holding the application for the existing proposal in abeyance, and that we can return to that if for some reason the council is not amenable to an ordinance change, and with the further understanding that we would plan to be back to the board in time for their June meeting with a more comprehensive revised proposal, provided the board got some preliminary indication from the council that they would like to consider this.
Okay, it's understood then that we'll hold in abeyance the existing plan until the June meeting, so the tabling motion should be until the June meeting, at which time we will consider again your proposal for existing proposal or any alternatives that you have at that point before us. Presumably you will be in attendance at the council meeting as well to get your own sense and feel for the reaction by the town council.
The council meeting is on April 30th?
It's unknown when they will schedule on their agenda, and their agendas like ours require some semblance of timeliness, and I would presume that Mr. Butler will communicate to you when that council meeting will be.
Just a point of interest, I will be unavailable until the first of May.
Okay, then you can watch it on tape when you get back. Hopefully.
Is your motion in order?
A motion is in order.
Okay. Be it ordered that the application of Stonegate Phase 4, a 22-lot major subdivision proposed by Stonegate Associates for preliminary plan approval should be tabled to the June meeting with mutual agreement by the board and the applicant. Should we add something in here about the ordinance request or not?
I think that that would be sufficient. We'll come back in June and evaluate one or the other. It's been moved and
seconded
to table Stonegate Phase 4 to the June meeting of the Planning Board. Any further discussion? Mr. Butler.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, would the motion include all of the relevant approvals, subdivision, wetlands, resource protection, as well?
I would amend it to include them all.
As does my agreement.
Fine.
Mr. Chairman, I would just ask a question, if I may, on the historical reference as to how long the 1,000-foot requirement has been an ordinance, where it came from, what drove it to arrive at that point, so that not only this board, but also that the town council can be aware of that historical reference as part of their deliberation.
Excellent point. Thank you. That will be in our letter, and copies of the letter will be sent to the planning board members as well. Good point. The motion has been amended to include the various components, preliminary plan review, wetlands alteration, permit for construction in a resource protection district, and amendment to a previously approved plan. Is that understood for a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. And opposed? Unanimous vote. Thank you, Mr. Taylor. I may still be a voting member for all issues tonight. Replacing Jen, yes.
Okay.
Next item on the agenda is Berwick Woods. A 17-lot subdivision proposed by Mr. Edward Drinan. The Spurwink Woods subdivision proposal before us tonight is for an application completeness vote. The issues are whether or not the board deems the application complete, whether it wishes to arrange for a sidewalk, and a public hearing. There is also an issue that we talked about in our last workshop session regarding public sewers, new subdivisions in the community where on-site subsurface waste disposal is proposed. Since that is a generic issue that relates to a number of subdivisions, we'll hold that until the end of the meeting, where we have an agenda talking about a letter to be sent to the town council. And this evening, the issues are application completeness, public hearing, and sidewalk. Good evening, Mr. Drynan.
Good evening, Mr. Tinsman, and other members of the board. Last month, a review of our application completeness checklist indicated that the community impact analysis had not been provided. Since that time, it has been provided, along with a wetlands report, a wildlife habitat evaluation, and a revised sewer plan and profile should the site become sewered. We feel that the application is complete, and I would welcome your questions or comments.
Thank you. The board has received the new material that has been submitted on Spurwink Woods. Just as a comment, it is probably one of the most complete impact analysis documents that I've seen, and may set the standard for additional impact analysis, community impact analysis sections for applications that come before the board. Well done.
Thank you. I have to say that it's the only part of the entire checklist that I might have some familiarity with. Most of them are engineering details and other things, and but being a resident of the community, I have a particular interest in this, and I found it very interesting.
So do we. Mr. Butler, comments on the completeness of the application?
I think in terms of completeness, the applicant's done a good job of meeting the remaining items that were outstanding regarding the public sewer facility item 8A, dealing with some of the natural features issues. I think that was included in the community impact analysis, as well as 24, which was the other outstanding issue that wasn't in the last submission, which was the community impact analysis. So from my reading, it looks like it's a complete application.
Thank you, Mr. Butler. Comments by planning board members?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr.
On the community impact analysis, there is a revenue discussion of total revenue. Is it appropriate for the community impact analysis to also discuss total costs, costs for school services, police services, public works services? I mean, that's what I assumed that we would find at the end of the community impact analysis, so we had something of a benchmark to compare revenue against costs. Mm-hmm. Not that that's going to be the deciding factor in whether we approve any project, but.
That's a good point, particularly as this may set the standard for other community impact analysis issues that come before the town. To that extent, we could consider this a complete application in that material is submitted. The technical review, which is separate from the application completeness, that's an appropriate question that Mr. Drynan could respond to and be prepared at some point in time to address.
Good question.
It'd be a lot harder than the analysis of the income. But it would be an interesting exercise and a very valuable one. Other comments by board members? Application completeness.
Mr. Chairman, I also find that the application be what I consider to be complete. Do we take up the technical aspects at this point, or should that come later?
One of the things that we should find tonight is application completeness and the public hearing and set of sidewalk. At any time in the application process, the technical questions could and should come up. Mm-hmm. So if there is an issue, I'm sure Mr. Drynan would like to hear about it early on.
At the last meeting, I mentioned the traffic study as part of the community impact study, and I reviewed it once again. I made mention in the last meeting that there was some disjointed information. Part of a good impact or any analytical study is that when a person reads a report, you come up with a reasonably easy chore of coming up with a similar deduction. I don't find that in here. I find that, that the application is complete, but I think, and I recommend it when we get further into the discussion, just to satisfy my own questions, that perhaps Mr. Bray might be here at one of the meetings.
I took into account your request regarding that traffic impact analysis and through land use consultants, passed that on to Mr. Bray. I read his traffic report more carefully after your comments. I reviewed other traffic impact analyses by from other developments, and Mr. Bray is not here tonight because I thought that with the time allotted, you may not wish to pursue that matter. However, I'd be happy to if you'd like. But I would appreciate more specifically if you could those areas that you feel are disjointed read well.
Okay. I guess one issue. On a specific issue, and then I'm going to address some general issues. In the report, it refers to Mitchell Road from Chevres North and utilizes one figure for the two-way traffic. Then it refers to Mitchell Road from Woodland South, which is the same stretch of road. In the maps, there are no other intersections, no inlets, outlets. Narratively, it doesn't explain any other inlets. It's the same stretch of road, but it gives a different number. Information like that that doesn't fit. I had a hard time, and I read the environmental impact analysis for projects on a daily basis. Maybe I'm just not catching his drift here. I think on a general issue, I'm extremely concerned. I was not a participant in the last project that was before us, but it's also on Mitchell Road. I've done a little research on Mitchell Road. I live on Mitchell Road also, by the way. But as to the total number of approved living units that directly access that, and it's around 525 that directly access Mitchell Road. My concern is that if some infrastructural change needs to be done, that we as planners can't wait till that last project that breaks the camel or the road's back. That we need to take a look at both the last project, your project, and all others that are going to be adding to the increased traffic if we're going to make some change. That may require some study by the town, an independent study. I guess I'm concerned about the Chevres Street intersection, along with some others. I read back through some of the historical data from a letter that we received, I think, 2 or 3 months ago. Back in 1983, our town engineer stated that we were at 90% of a local guideline, which I tried to reference, and I didn't get a real clear reading on that. And I just mentioned that as Mitchell Road is not up to design standards and is accident prone, especially in this area, I believe it would be prudent to require more intensive traffic analysis. My only comment at this point is your application before us is one of those projects adding to that. And I think it's prudent for us as planners to see what the comprehensive effect of all of that might be.
I think that's an excellent example of giving early feedback to a developer in a process, and an important one, as traffic has been considered an important issue on Mitchell Road. Further to that, and in very appropriate comments, Steve, let us request through Steve Butler, staff, to the planning board that he communicate with the town manager, and with the town manager's permission, discussions with the town engineer about the evaluation of both the Spurwink Woods and the Stonegate Phase 4 subdivision plans as they combine for traffic issues along Mitchell Road to ensure that our level of service that have been cited in this application of level of service A exists at acceptable design standards along Mitchell Road.
Okay.
And that's an appropriate and good question. Judith?
I agree with that, and I think, you know, each development has sort of its item with me that means a lot to me. In the previous one, it's the access. In this one, what Steve said is very true. I also want you to know that it's not you we're picking on, or at least I'm not picking on. But you live in the area, as do I. And if we can prove or convince ourselves that it's an okay street, you know, it's a crummy S-curve in there with banks and driveways and people parking to buy petunias and a lot of little streets coming in. Those are the things we have to think about, as well as the fact Hobstone is now putting in another building. They have another phase that will be coming up in the next few years or however months. We have Stonegate 4 that's going in. There's a lot of use that's going to happen on that road. And I don't want you to feel that you're taking the burden of, I'm the bad guy that put the last horrible car on Mitchell Road.
No,
But you know, you've driven that road as many times as any one of us has, and it's a tough spot.
And this is the first time I've ever brought forward a development proposal, and I've been surprised to see that the traffic impact analysis, like many sections of our ordinance, particularly these 50-foot road rights-of-way and 22, 24-foot paved rights-of-way for a small 19-house neighborhood. Anyway, regarding traffic, I've been surprised to find that the ordinances and rules and regulations regarding traffic has to do with the state-designated type of road that it is and the number of cars that travel on it, more so than actually the construction of the road itself. And I live on Mitchell Road, and in the 15 years that I've lived in Cape Elizabeth, I've only voiced one concern to the public authorities regarding traffic, a one-time incident, and that was on the curve at Chevers Road. An incident occurred where some bad driving was going on. And I know that Mitchell Road has less than 20 feet of paved way, and it's a 50-foot right-of-way. And my own personal feeling is that by shaving a couple of the insides and outside corners of those S-turns there, which is public property, town property, that we could really alleviate a lot of the problem on the two S-curves.
Mm-hmm.
At Chevres and then going around the corner as you head north.
Right, which is a really tough one there. It's very blind.
I tend to think of it more of a town public works situation. I would really like to see it corrected.
Mr. Chairman?
No, I think I agree. I think this is, let's take a look at it. I think that Steve's suggestion to have a town, it's a bad spot.
I guess my most pointed question, if Mr. Bray were going to be here, was if he were, as a traffic engineer, going to design a street intersection for 300 cars per hour, AM and PM peak, would he design it as the present Chevres intersection is designed? And if not, how he would redesign it? I'm not an engineer, but that's what I think we need to look at.
Yeah, and we're looking at that, and I, as a citizen, I think I just might put that recommendation of his to the appropriate, to the town manager, for instance.
And I echo Judy's concern. We're not pinpointing on one. I mentioned that just as concerned for the Stonegate application as I was for Meadow View. I think that's the name of it, across from the street from that. I will bring it up again when the Congregate Care comes up, its influence on Scott Dyer and Route 77. I think it's an issue that we need to look at and step back and look at.
I agree.
What are the board's wishes on application completeness and public hearing and sidewalk? Is there a motion?
Chairman, I move that we accept it as a complete application and schedule a site walk.
Okay. Part of the motion should also be for the setting of a public hearing and presumably the board wishes to have that public hearing at its May 15th meeting.
That's correct.
Motion has been made.
Second.
And seconded that the preliminary plan application for Spurwink Woods, a 17-lot major subdivision located off Chevers Road and Macaulay Road, and proposed by Edward Drynan, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 16.2.4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, and be it further ordered that the planning board will hold a public hearing on this application at its May 15th meeting. So moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
I would just like to make one comment. This application shows a subdivision plan that also includes grading plans for the lots and I believe proposed house locations. I think that that's an excellent way of looking at subdivisions. I think a lot of the issues that arise after a subdivision has been developed is neighbors fighting against neighbors, trying to solve drainage problems that were never considered beyond the 50-foot right-of-way. So I think in that sense, that's a very good part of this application.
Good comment. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, for approval, please raise your hands. This raising your hand stuff is confusing. All those opposed, it is the unanimous decision. Now for a site walk. Presumably, we would want to hold our site walk prior to the public hearing so we have a sense and feel for the landform that the subdivision is located on. I would propose for the planning board that we consider May 12th, a Saturday, for a site walk. What are the feelings of the members?
That's fine with me.
I won't be here, but I'll be sure to walk the site.
Okay. May 12th, then at 10 o'clock in the morning?
Good.
Sounds good.
Sounds good. Should be awake by then.
We will have our site walk on May 12th at 10 o'clock. We would like to have the road at least flagged so that we can see where the road is and any other features that you particularly want to point out. We will traverse the whole site looking at the wetlands.
Should we come in through Chevers Road? Where would you want us to
park? Most convenient place to park is at the cul-de-sac at the end of Chevers and Macaulay. There's a town-owned lot right here.
So we will meet there at 10 o'clock on May 12th.
I might also ask that in some way, whether the four corners or however you designate the, excuse me, the area where the designated proposed common sewer area might be, is flagged.
Yes. Thank you for your comment, Mr. Emery. I'm eager to show all of you members the site, and I think you'll see that it's been tailor-made for individual house lots. And if anybody can't make it, please call me, we can look at it at your convenience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carney. Next item on the agenda is under new business, Mr. Arnold Murray, who proposes to substitute an existing overboard discharge system with an on-site subsurface disposal system. Is Mr. Murray here? And he is. Welcome.
Good evening. I'm Arnold Murray, and I live in Fowler Road. Yeah, I'm here tonight seeking approval for a removal of an existing overboard wastewater treatment system located at my summer home in Peebles Cove and replacing it with a subsurface disposal system. Now, the old system has had a long history of malfunction as observed by the DEP tester, Susan Willard. She would be very pleased to get rid of this system. And so would I. In your packet, there's a letter from James Nichols of the DEP on this subject, and I will read a paragraph from this letter. It says, the overboard discharge law now in effect requires that existing overboard discharges not be relicensed if there is an alternative. The intent of this law is to improve the quality of Maine's waters by removing as many overboard discharges as possible. The Department of Human Services has approved the subsurface disposal system, and there's a letter in your packet from Jay Hardcastle regarding this. Now, Ernie McVeigh has also viewed the site and sees no problem with the proposed new system. I have a DEP permit, by rule permit, for a for disturbance of material adjacent to a wetland or water body as required. I filed an application with the DEP for a sand dune permit, but on March 13, 1990, I received a letter from Douglas Burdick of the DEP stating that this replacement does not require a sand dune permit. Steve Butler has a copy of this letter. See, I do need approval from the planning board as it is in an RP zone.
Thank you, sir. Good presentation. Any questions by planning board members of Mr. Murray? Tom.
Mr. Murray, was there ever any discussion about providing a holding tank rather than a leach field with the DEP?
The DEP says that's the last alternative. If there's nothing else, then they would require that, but that's the last thing that they want to do.
Is your consultant here tonight, Mr. Malley?
No, he's in Florida, unfortunately. I wish he was.
In looking at your application, I noticed that your leach field is only, it appears to be 6.5 feet away from the adjacent property line. I had a question. It seems as though 10 feet is a typical dimension that I've seen in the past, but I'm certainly not a site evaluator.
Well, he had Jay Hartgessel from the state there with him, and they came up with this, so apparently it's...
Is your residence winterized at this point?
No.
Do you anticipate winterizing your residence?
Not really.
I guess I'll direct a question at the chairman. I think what we have here is a somewhat of a grandfathered situation, but from the description in the application, the mention of sand dunes and adjacent wetlands and resource protection area, it would seem to me that if this were a new construction happening today, there's no way in the world this building would find itself on this location. And that's not unusual in the Maine coast. And as was mentioned earlier regarding traffic, I'm not picking on you as an individual. What I'm trying to do is understand in my mind why certain people end up with certain houses in certain locations that are environmentally very sensitive. And when other people come up to us and ask, how in the world could you approve a septic system on a sand dune, particularly if that turns out, that makes that house a year-round residence, that's something I'd be able to like to answer for myself as well. I don't know if it's appropriate to this application, but it seems to me that if there's a summer residence within a resource protection district, is there some protection in the ordinance, Steve, that would restrict the ability to turn that into a year-round residence, which would be probably more easily to do with a new septic system than it would be with a holding tank?
There's nothing under the RP section, at least that I can see, and I think you'd be getting more into the plumbing code side of things rather than zoning or subdivision side.
Any further questions, Tom?
No, I guess at this point we're really looking at our state experts and so forth in reviewing this application. I'll just, as a comment, I'll say I'm very surprised at their interpretation, but they are who they are.
Thank you. Any other board comments or questions?
I might just say the DEP that has changed the rules on the subsurface treatment systems that they approve for a replacement of overboard discharge.
Mm-hmm.
It is their opinion that this is the best alternative. Mr. Murray is correct that the holding tank is the least preferred alternative. Thank you. I think the only thing that restricts this property here is that the present time you have a seasonal water supply in that area, and I believe it still is seasonal. I think what this presentation just shows us is that what the DEP, the Human Services, and Mr. Murray has come up with is the best alternative at this point.
What are the wishes of the board? Anybody there?
I'll move.
Judith.
The whole thing, huh?
Yes.
Okay. Be it ordered that the planning board finds that the application of Arnold Murray for planning board permit for construction in a resource protection district for replacement of an existing overboard discharge system with new individual subsurface wastewater treatment system in the vicinity of Alewife Brook Road and Peebles Cove Road meets the following standards of section 19-2-8, subparagraph C. One, that it will not result in unsafe or unhealthful conditions. Two, that it will not result in erosion or sedimentation. Three, will not result in water pollution. Four, will not result in damage to spawning grounds, fish, aquatic life, bird, and other wildlife habitat. Five, will conserve natural beauty. And six, will avoid problems associated with floodplain development and use.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that the request of Arnold Murray for a planning board permit in a resource protection district in the vicinity of Alewife Brook Road and Peebles Cove Road be granted in accordance with section 19-2-8 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. And opposed? One dissenting vote, Ms. Bammer. You have the special permit, Ms. Murray. Good
Thank
luck.
You.
Sorry it took so long to get to you. Next item on the agenda is for Jones East Service Station at 298 Ocean House Road. Greg Jones is here this evening to present a concept and an idea of what the proposed canopy would look like that he is proposing for Jones East Service Center, and to do some planning with us relating to issues of landscaping and parking on newly acquired or to be acquired pieces of his property. Mr. Jones, welcome and good evening.
Thank you. As you noted, I have two applications before the board. I've been told the first we should deal with is the zone extension. We are in agreement with the adjacent property owner to buy from them 30 feet of additional property. The property owner is the Methodist Church next door to us. The zone line goes right between us now, and if we were to acquire this land, we would need it to be rezoned in order to make use of it. Our plans are to make it additional parking space because of the some of the renovations we plan to do will reduce the amount of parking we have on the opposite side of our lot. We feel as far as the zone change goes, it's within the ramifications of the ordinance standards, and will have no detrimental effect to the overall neighborhood. About all I can say on that one.
Okay, we have two issues before us. One is to approve a site plan change for your canopy, and presumably once the, and the second issue is the zone change request from a residence A district to a business A district for lands adjoining you for your new parking. So there are really two issues, the site plan. One is the parking and one is the canopy mm-hmm. issue. And the parking issue cannot proceed until we have a zone change, as I understand it. With that in mind, I would presume that the planning board this evening would want to deal with the tougher of the two issues, and that is the zone change request. And you've expressed some comment about that. And perhaps before we do that, if you have any drawings of what your proposed canopy and perhaps what the zone change request will provide you and how that will need to be then voted on by the planning board for any site plan changes to allow parking to exist, that would be appropriate.
So I stand these here?
Yeah, on the chairs is fine, or if we can, everybody see them that far away?
What happened to our stand?
I have copies of these, but the copies don't have the color.
I think one of the previous applicants either took his or our stand away with him. Good.
There we go.
Glad an applicant didn't try to lug that up.
This is the existing lot right here. Excuse me, this line right here. And the additional 30 feet is this rectangular area here and along our backside. The canopy we propose will go directly over the new dispensers. The new dispensers will be approximately in the same location as the current one, although they'll be spread out a little bit more. The canopy being moved and the dispensers being moved a little bit to the south side of the lot makes it necessary for us to restrict the parking along the white building, which is adjacent to it. Our plans are to totally remove any parked cars on this side, and therefore we need more space on the opposite side. In addition to that, we plan on grassing in and putting some type of shrubbery in this corner because the adjacent tenants, the tenants of this adjacent building tend to use this triangle, which is our property, and it has some effect on site view and so forth. So the canopy is 30 by 50, freestanding, two columns in between the four dispensers. The dispensers are the new type, which have three hoses on each side. They're not the round mobile style pumps of yesteryear. The only thing in addition will be some minor interior renovations will be done, but that's the only change. Aside, I should mention, from the original reason for this whole job is to replace our underground storage tank, which is required by state law. We currently, two of them are about 24 years old. We have until next fall to do that. We want to do this work in conjunction with that and make a completely renovated, to some extent, a completely renovated work, especially from a modern standpoint. Well needed, and we hope it will have obvious positive effects in the business standpoint.
How will the canopy be lit? What will the lighting be like?
It'll be 12 exposed square lights underneath it, four rows of three. The lights will be, as I understand, 400 watts each. They're designed to shine the light down underneath. Of course, some of it is going to spread through the yard. Approximately 10 to 20 feet of this amount of the yard will be lit from these lights. The only additional lighting will be what we currently have, one here and one here. There'll be replacements of new ones, but we won't be adding them.
Do you have a drawing of what your proposed canopy would look like?
To some extent, I have elevation drawing that was done for us. Obviously, this is the front. There are some errors associated with this. This blue canopy, that would be the canvas one. But this shows that the canopy would have two columns. Although you're looking straight on, you can only see the first one. And these are the dispensers. It would be positioned, as noted here, approximately, I believe it's 10 feet beyond the edge of the building this way. And about, this is about 8 or 10 feet from the building itself this way. And this side view, again, shows the side of the dispensers. And to some extent shows the lighting.
Hey, Greg, you've simplified what could be a very complicated process because you're requesting a couple of things at a couple of different times. One is the canopy and one is the parking. But from what you indicated, they seem to be related. You can't do the canopy because of its position without having the additional parking. Okay. I think it would simplify matters for the board and for you if we dealt with a zone change request in light of your proposed site plan changes. And if you could, for a moment, go back to your site plan, the other drawing. I've got a couple of questions, and other board members, I'm sure, will have some questions as well. Jonesy's has always been in the forefront of doing landscaping and making an attractive service station within our community center. And as you know, the community has undertaken a town center concept where we're looking at improving dramatically for the whole community the town center as people drive in and through the community, either residents or visitors. And the planning board dealt with a request for a site plan application at Century 21 a few months ago, where we requested and received from the applicant a number of landscaping improvements to further strengthen that corner from a landscaping area as well as from a building area. Your proposal does a very similar improvement to your service station and to the service of the community by the residents who use Jonesy's, and there are a lot of us. There are a couple of concerns for landscaping in front of your building. You have an island out in front of you, which you've maintained, even though it's on town public land, providing a nice entrance to your site. You're also proposing, on the right-hand side of the drawing as we're looking at it, an increase in landscaping on that corner to provide for visual softening of the corner, as well as functionally to remove any vehicles from that area, and that's appropriate. A couple of issues come to mind. One is that, is there any way that you can close up the left entrance to the service center by extending that island as part of your project several feet? And I'm not talking about trying to make a 24-foot wide entrance on your left-hand side of the project, but extending it toward the left, towards, I believe, the north, sufficient length to at least give more of that visual separation between the road and Jonesy's, and also to reduce somewhat the amount of pavement that exists in our town center.
You're talking about right here?
Yes.
That would be agreeable to us, provided that we are allowed by the town or state to make such modifications, not being on our property.
We will address that through Steve Butler and talking with the town manager and the public works director. Okay. This, another issue relates to your proposed parking on the northerly boundary of your property as it insets on land that you... Have you purchased that land yet, or are you... Okay. You have an option. If the town approves the zone change and you're permitted to do that, is there any way that you can provide an area of landscaping between the publicly owned land and your new parking area, at least to screen some of that parking from cars going by and seeing that?
Is that right here?
Yes.
Certainly be a possibility. We don't need every inch of that, obviously, to create additional parking that we're trying to. So we certainly could extend the grass area that currently is right here. We certainly could extend that up into the new land and do something maybe in conjunction with what's down on the line.
Okay, we might want you to put in some height plantings, like some white pines in a staggered row in there, that so as the future of the community comes to us rapidly, that those cars that are parked there are screened from traffic going by. It would make a softer visual impression for your station as well as the public. Okay, other comments by board members? Tom?
Mr. Chairman, I have a number of comments. First of all, I may have a conflict of interest because I exclusively get my gas at Jonesy's, but I don't believe that's a conflict of interest. I'd like to, since Greg is here, I'd like to thank you for your community support and say that, again, it becomes very difficult when I think one has to be objective. We have to look you in the eye every day that we go in and fill up with gas. So I have several comments that may seem onerous for someone who wanted simply to replace some gas tanks. But unfortunately, in today's regulatory environment, when one starts out wanting to replace gas tanks, those things get chased all over the place. Concern I would have is increased runoff and drainage. I think that's something that you need to address prior to having approval of the site plan. It appears as though there's either a swale going at the edge of your property now that drains out back, and you're increasing probably considerably the impervious area by expanding your parking, and where that runoff goes and that increased runoff is something that I believe needs to be addressed. I moved to Cape Elizabeth for a lot of reasons, a lot of which we hear day in and day out, and that talks about the rural character. And when I hear about gas stations going modern and I hear about 400-watt lights, I see gas stations that are located next to interstate interchanges and on I-95 north of Atlanta, I-75 north of Atlanta, something that has to jump out from the magnet crowd, so to speak. And the only way to do that is with bigger signs, with brighter lights, because there isn't a great differentiation in the product line, so to speak, anymore. Although I wasn't part of the review for Cumberland Farms, I believe that they were required to do quite a number of things in order to make the conversion of that Sunoco station into a Cumberland Farms quite compatible. I would question whether or not the addition of a very brightly lighted canopy that is higher than the gas station is consistent with either the comprehensive plan or with the Main Street 90 goal to create a sense of downtown. I'm saying this also in consideration of the cumulative effect that Jonesy's is not the only gas station on Route 77, that we also have to consider that Irving is there and that sooner or later Cumberland Farms would come to us. And as one drives up the hill approaching wonderful rural downtown Cape Elizabeth in a late winter's afternoon, we're going to see a lot of very brightly lighted canopies. And that's of a real concern to me, and what I would like to see in order to deal with that is a sketch that would indicate the visual impact as one approaches up Route 77. And I'd also like to see that if I don't know where these canopies are designed or whether this is something that Mobile has as a standard line, I believe it is, someone from Mobile provide us with a light impact so we could see where the edge of the light impact on the adjacent properties would be. There's also a question I have in terms of front yard setback. I'll confess that I haven't reviewed the ordinance requirement for this zone. In some communities, the setback is to any building line. I believe in Cape Elizabeth it's to the foundation line, so you may be clear there. But it appears to me that the canopy is very close to the edge of the right-of-way there.
What are you talking about, front?
Yeah. Is that an issue, Steve?
I received the setback from
there are also, so that everyone here who's concerned with this would understand, I believe there's been a lot of clearing of trees behind the existing station, but I don't believe that has anything to do with your property.
That's correct.
That's right. Again, I think this is something that would set a precedent for the future aesthetic, so to speak, and visual image of downtown Cape Elizabeth, and something that the board should consider. With due respect for the fact that it's Jonesy's, but also consider in terms of its accumulative impact. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Other board members, comments? Ivan.
On the area that you're going to add for additional parking, in addition to the runoff effects, I'd be interested in if that's going to be all paved. Is it going to be paved and striped? How will the cars be parked back there? Will there be cars in permanent residence back there, or are they going to be temporary type?
There's definitely any permanent cars in our one.
Okay.
To answer your question, we do anticipate paving
that
all
okay.
To make use of it. As far as the parking goes, because there's a lot of possibilities with this open space out back, we can't see from the street. We'll obviously be some doubling up out here. And long-term parking would be difficult. Vehicle towed in for the rest or something will be out back because we know it's going to be there when we get to regular parking would probably be single line, but it is now here, would be set back to 30 feet, and to some extent probably along here. Of course, it would depend on how busy they are that day on the side of the field. But this will make a huge impact on those days when, especially the tire change of season, when the water is just going past.
Jerry.
Question on the proposal. I realize that you're mandated by state law to change your tanks on that, but in looking at your other proposal, I understand that having a mobile credit card and using other facilities around the state, the company has gone to that type of gas pump. Is there a way that you might be able to update your facility without a canopy?
Yes, you could put the dispensers in without the canopy itself. However, to achieve the increased gallonage, which would be necessary to make this project, the canopy would be an essential ingredient for that plan.
So you really feel, as a resident and a businessman in the community, that you're going to attract more people into your business by having a canopy as opposed to
that?
Not.
Is it going to be self-service more?
Progressively is more self-service at this time as well. It's getting more. Yeah. And that, again, is the background to make it comfortable for the consumer who's pumping in May, 80% of the gas.
Other planning board members' comments?
Mr. Chairman, I think I've lost track of where we are a little bit. Are we approaching the zoning issue first or the site plan review?
We have to approach the zoning issue, I believe, and we must do it in the context of what's being proposed in terms of the site plan change.
Does the change or the request for the change in zoning require a public hearing?
Yes, it will.
I guess before I have many questions about the zoning change itself, I have plenty of questions about the site review. Jonesy's realized, they're the center of town, and we're very proud of our town center. When the Balfour property was before us, it's kind of painful putting them through all those paces to acquire some of the improvements that we felt were necessary. I think you're going to go through the same thing, and you should be proud about that because you're a central image in the town. But again, I think we need to take care of the zoning issue first. I'd be interested. I don't have any questions about the zoning. I'm more interested in the abutters' opinions that they might have. I see it's a pretty minimal change, an extra 30-foot perimeter around the building. Seems to be fairly clear about what your intent is now and what might be. And I think we have some concerns about some additional buffering that would fall into that area. But that's going to take place after the zoning decision is made.
Agreed. Part and parcel of the zoning decision, though, is the site plan itself. And I would think that we would not want to move to the zone change if we were had the feeling that the site plan just was not appropriate. I haven't heard that. What I've heard are some modifications to the plans as presented, and I'll summarize those as we end the discussion from the board members. Mm-hmm. So that there's an understanding by Mr. Jones. Steve.
Mr. Chair, maybe just a clarifier for everybody. At the end of the zoning ordinance, I guess it's section 19.4.9b, there's information about what needs to be required and what's there. And one of the items under that talks about a site plan being provided. So I think it's interesting and somewhat fortunate for the applicant that we're both at the same time. So they are interrelated, but when you get down to the process, and you have to kind of pull back and do things in a sequential manner.
Okay. I guess some key issues that I see are drainage, a canopy. They tend to centralize the drainage. I mean, you're instead of precipitation landing on the pavement and just sheeting in a natural way, it comes down probably two drain pipes.
We have internal drain pipes.
Right.
Yeah.
That will have to be directed one way or another. The landscaping, the expansion of the island, I think it just would be, it would enhance your application to have part of our own packets what you foresee to be your final proposal. And it would be much easier for me if I could get a more clear picture of the canopy itself, what it's going to really look like.
I have some actual photographs of some canopies, but obviously they're not going to be...
my location, but this is basically what the canopy itself would look like. The absence of the word mold. I couldn't get that reproduced.
Could you leave that with us?
Yeah, Greg, why don't you give that to Steve Butler and we'll provide it as a part of the next submission.
Mr. Chairman?
Jerry first.
I had one other comment that I forgot about and brought back. There are commercial products available for possible use in that 30-foot section where you have a concrete-made item that you can set in the ground on the subsurface that allows for a lot of drainage, and you actually have grass growing up through it so that it would look like a lawn, but in essence you've got a concrete base to work with and it does ease your drainage problem. You might consider, I don't know what your costs are, but you might consider using that in a chunk of your side 30-foot out there.
Ivan?
On that side, adjacent to the church, I think in the site plan we'd like to see any buffering that you have planned.
They requested that we put a strip of cedars.
Okay.
And we agreed to that. This area is maybe we do with own house would be heavily wooded.
For some reason, I didn't get that in my packet, so that's why I'm asking.
It's down on the ledges, too. This area here slopes up and then back down again all the way over to Joseph's parking lot. There's a huge amount, I don't know what the footage is, it's in terms of acres.
Yeah, it's a long way.
Between us and the parking lot, as well as on that. But they did request a strip of cedars.
Okay.
And we said no problem with that. And also, as far as the vegetation goes, I spoke with Henry Adams, who's heading up to the Street 90 Town Center beautification project, and I asked him what he was doing. I know they busted up the cement and asked what was going in. He indicated mostly grass with some greenery of some kind around the signpost. I told him I would maybe do something in conjunction with them, as well as Scott Delphor across the street, who I understand is going to use some half barrel so that they can be the vegetation can be removed in the winter, which I think is key because of the plowing situation and the road salt and so forth. This land, this area here gets pummeled by the plowing every year. The curbing is torn right away, and it would be tough to maintain any type of shrubbery and keep it working for the time without water.
That's an excellent idea, and in that way you've got a similar landscaping on both sides of an important intersection in the community. If I may summarize some of the points and have board members indicate any other changes that they might request. Presuming that we vote this evening to go ahead with the zone change request instead of public hearing, that the planning board members are indicating to you, Greg, that there's a desire for a perspective drawing, an oblique drawing, not only the elevations, but as you come up the road, what you would see when you see the proposed new parking area and the additional landscaping in front and the canopy and what it does to your facility. We have the pictures that you presented tonight, which are indicative of the type of canopy that you proposed, those are appropriate, and that you provide an oblique drawing of what your proposal will look like. There was a comment about reducing the amount of lighting to the minimum allowed or required by mobile or design standards for underneath canopy park pumping. If 400 watt is the minimum by standards that is allowed, then that may be appropriate. We'll have to consider it on that basis. If there's a different lighting level that is still safe, still appropriate, and less of a major amount of lighting, that is something that the board is asking you to consider and look at. The issue of drainage and how you propose to accomplish not only the drainage off the canopy, but in the proposed new parking area, which would be paved or not, depending on what you propose out there. And the issue of landscaping and how you propose to screen the new parking on the northerly boundary property from Route 77 and the extension of a publicly owned island in front of the service center, extending that to close off part of the opening of Jonesy's. Are there other issues that I've missed in summarizing, Tom?
One other is the issue on the, you spoke about the ledge. I don't know if you talked about sort of maintaining the natural edge there. Maybe you used the term buffer along Main Street. We don't have any indication on, at least I don't have on the small survey plan, of significant trees located within that 30-foot setback. It would seem to me that given the way in which your cars, you're able, because of a valet parking situation almost, you can work around existing trees, perhaps clustering trees, and rather than investing a lot of money trying to, I mean, I know it costs a lot of money to cut down a tree and then plant them back. If you can endeavor to preserve some of the existing specimen large oak trees in that area, I think it would be helpful to the overall plan as well.
Greg, do you understand, Judith?
We're gonna go on a sidewalk, aren't we?
We should.
I think we should.
Yes.
That'd be a good time to look at that.
Okay. Perhaps at our May 12th meeting, May 12th sidewalk that we already have, since we're together on a Saturday morning. Greg, do you understand the concerns and comments of the planning board members? Okay. What are the planning board wishes on this item?
Mr. Chairman, I want to be absolutely clear on one issue. From what Steve said, it sounded as though we can have the zoning change contingent upon a satisfactory site plan review.
I didn't hear Steve say that. I heard him say that the zone change should be part and parcel of a site plan being in our hands and an application for it. And correct me if I'm wrong, Steve, but the zone change itself is an issue of vote that's quite separate. I think I had indicated that we should consider the two somewhat part and parcel by understanding the site plan issues as we're looking at the zone change request.
I guess I also need to have one thing clarified. Do we need to have, or can the need to have a public hearing? Can that be way before a vote?
The public hearing is a requirement of the zone change request, not necessarily the site plan review. Thank you.
That's correct. I'd like to make a motion.
Mr. Most.
Okay. Be it ordered that the request for a zone change from a residence, Katrina zone change first.
Yes.
From a residence A district to a business A district for land bordering Jonesy Service Station located at 298 Ocean House Road is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 1949 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented. Be it further ordered that the planning board will hold a public hearing on this request at 15th of May.
The motion has been made.
I second it.
And seconded for setting the zone change request application being deemed complete and setting it for the May 15th meeting. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. And opposed? Unanimous vote. To the issue of site plan. On the completeness review, Mr. Butler.
Some things, actually, in terms of completeness, not necessarily sufficiency, it was close to being a complete application. The one thing on number one, an item which wasn't missing, but which has been referenced already by the board, was the fact that there weren't elevations. I think if the applicant's willing to provide those, at least with respect to the canopy, that would be fine. And there's some examples that were shown this evening. The two other issues were that are there were that I called partial were the fact that, again, these have already been mentioned and addressed by the board, landscaping and buffering plans, a lot of the existing as well as the proposed vegetation wasn't shown on the plans. It was referenced somewhat in the materials, but not shown. Greg and I have talked about that. Same thing with lighting details. Again, concerned that perhaps a little more information could be provided than what was included in the application materials. Other than that, in terms of completeness, it was fairly complete.
Just a comment on the landscaping and buffering plan and the lighting details. The applicant has proposed landscaping and has proposed lighting in his application. Whether it is sufficient for approval process is not an issue of completeness. That something has been submitted. We then determine whether it's sufficient in a review of the site plan and then a vote of the site plan, approval or denial. So in terms of data being presented, there has been some data presented. Comments by planning board or wishes of the planning board? Tom?
One comment. Under item lighting details, it says driveway entry lights will be replaced with new, modern, more efficient ones. Where are those on the site plan?
They would be an exact location of the old ones. One is here, and the other is here.
Do you have a, do we know what wattage those are, or do you have a catalog cut that shows those?
No, I do have a photograph. I think it shows both the old ones. This is the pump style we have, and this is the new one.
Greg, again, I would ask that perhaps you could leave that with Steve Butler, and he can copy and disseminate it to the board for the next meeting. Questions, comments, wishes of the board?
I think, Mr. Chairman, that the items that we're to review seem to be reasonably complete. I think the applicant understands that of the items that have been submitted, we're requesting a number of some changes, some improvements, some additional information. I don't think that necessarily deems the application incomplete. It's just that it can be improved upon. Am I guessing right?
I would presume
okay.
So.
I would, should I be making a motion? Are we ready for motion?
I believe so.
Okay. Let me, be it ordered, I move that the site plan application for construction of a canopy and additional parking for James Jonesy Service Station Center located at 298 Ocean House Road is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 19.29B of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
You've heard the motion.
Mr. Chairman,
I
guess I'm perplexed because I don't have anything in front of me that even indicates that there's a site plan that's been submitted other than a plan of the existing building and something showing the proposed property line and a hand-drawn canopy outline. So based on that, I could support the motion.
Okay. Moved. And
seconded
that the application is deemed to be complete. Again, the board would want to point out that completeness data being submitted doesn't necessarily indicate sufficient for approval, and that there are a number of other issues that would have to be submitted if the board voted that it was complete application. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your right hand or left hand. Opposed? One negative vote.
I'm abstaining, should you know. I just did not get that in my packet. I don't feel confident about voting on the plan.
Mr. Moses is abstaining.
All right,
okay. Thank you very much. We will be having a public hearing on your zone change request at the May 15th meeting. We'll be holding off on decision on the site plan based on new data that you'll be presenting to us. I would encourage you to talk to Mr. Butler about his views about what you might wish to present to the board to achieve a favorable vote in the next couple of days. We do have requirements for submission, as you know, for so far in advance of a particular mm-hmm. meeting. And Steve can assist you in determining that schedule and the data that he sees the board requiring. On a site plan visit, site walk, we have mentioned May 12th. Is that appropriate for the board members?
Would it be possible to do it independently?
Absolutely. I would expect that if it were independent, that, Greg, you could meet the planning board members on an individual basis, those that are not able to show up on May 12th, uh-huh. and show them what is being proposed. And are you available on May 12th to show us?
Presumably.
I'm sorry?
Presumably.
Okay, good. We are at another site walk. Previously at Spurwick Woods, that should take an hour and a half, 2 hours, 2 hours. So we would be at Jonesy's at around noon or shortly after on May 12th. Thank you very much and good presentation. The next item on the agenda is Elizabeth Heights' proposal for congregate care by First Atlantic Corporation. And the Elizabeth Heights, as an applicant, has First Atlantic, as an applicant, has submitted a number of conceptual drawings. Background for the board: First Atlantic has been with us at a number of meetings over the last couple of years and has provided a history of their involvement in Cape Elizabeth as we're looking at zone changes necessary to allow the application to come before the board. This evening we'll be looking at, for the first time, the application as it's now conceptualized. And I've mentioned in our preparatory data that perhaps we could hold a very detailed couple-hour session on this at our May workshop so that it would allow us the time to really get into the mechanics of your proposal and to share with you our thoughts. So with that, First Atlantic.
Chairman and members of the board, my name is Dan Horahan. I'm here on behalf of First Atlantic Corporation. We are the owners and developers of Elizabeth Heights, which, as the chairman has mentioned, is a congregate care retirement community proposed for Scott Dyer Road. The site contains approximately 32 acres. It abuts the Viking Nursing Home. It's contained in the RC zone. To summarize the history of the project, back in early 86, we formed a joint venture with another partner who we have since bought out their interest and came before this board in a pre-app conference to discuss a project which was much larger in scope than what we are now presenting. At that point, back in July of 86, we presented a project on this site which contained in excess of 200 units, and under the RC zone, a home for the aged was a conditional use within that zone, so we were instructed at that point to go towards the Zoning Board of Appeals and request a conditional use permit for our project under the home for the aged definition. At that point, the Zoning Board of Appeals found that the project did not fit within that definition, and we went to the City Council and requested an amendment to the comprehensive plan to allow congregate housing in the RC zone. It took us approximately 2 years, and I see some familiar faces right now, but I also see some new faces, so I'd like to just briefly summarize where the project is at now, in fact, and reiterate that we have been working together for, I think it's about 4 years right now, on the original plan, the amendment to the zoning ordinance to allow this use with a density of 6 units per acre. Currently, the project is developed to have 75 units, 45 two-bedrooms, 31 bedrooms. It's a very residential, residential-looking project as far as a home for the elderly. It's a new term called congregate housing, which really encompasses an activities program, central dining, housekeeping, personal care assistance available, transportation program, lots of common area space within the project to accommodate the needs of what we hope will be a very active resident. The project has taken into consideration all the environmental restrictions of the site. It is 32 acres. We've met with Steve Butler over the past few months to try to address all of the issues in the ordinance regarding wetlands, buffers, height, setbacks, etc. With me tonight is Will Poger and also Frank Cushing of Gowran Architects to discuss any questions you have in detail. And in fact, I'd like to turn it over right now to Frank Cushing so he could discuss the landscape plan in more detail.
One of the cog aerials which would help you put the site into context with the community around it. The 30-acre parcel land is about 2,400 feet west of Route 77. We have it outlined here in the pink. You can see it is bounded to the north by a vacant parcel land, to the west by vacant land, to the south by vacant land, and to the east by Longfellow Drive, a moderate density subdivision. Of the 30 acres, there are 7.8 acres of pedestrian wetland. I will put up excerpts from a site analysis we performed on the property. Gives you an indication of how and why we're choosing our building site where we are.
Excuse me, could I ask that you maybe bring the microphone to you so that others in the audience can hear and those that are at home can also follow along with us?
The areas that are shaded in blue are the emergent pedestrian wetlands. The lower area shaded in gray on the bottom of the drawing is that wetland associated with the Spurwink River. The area shaded in a sandy color is glacial soils of glacial origin, where our geotechnical engineers are telling us we would have the best possible foundation for our structure. Also indicated are the best views on the site, and of course the red arrows would indicate the backyards of the existing residences along Longfellow Drive. Call a panorama photograph that was taken of the site. It was used all along the site design process, and I want to be able to look at them so you can get a feeling of what the property is actually like. It was agricultural land, it's in process of succession. And it will also show you where the approximate building site is. It's located 1,200 feet back from Scott Dyer Road. So it's a considerable distance into the site. Through the site analysis, determined the best possible location for that structure to minimize impacts around the community or around the site, and to also take advantages of the benefits that the site has to offer to our residents that will be living here. If you remember the shaded area, we had an option of orienting our structure in a number of directions, but we've chosen to orient it south, one for the solar exposure, but also to show as little of the structure to the residences along Longfellow Drive. We were also taking advantage of the slope of the topography of the building site. We were setting the structure down a full story into grade to minimize any height impacts to those residences. I have tried to lay out a gracious, inviting driveway here. We're calling it a private driveway. We'd like to have it that character. We've kept it along a property line, starting at a point of origin on Scott Dyer Road, where our best point of sight line is. And we've hugged the property line down into the site and then swept easterly towards Longfellow Drive to skirt around a wetland. Once we're around the wetland, we've come back westerly and then have a clear view of our front door, which is a very nice thing to do. You can, what's illustrated here is pretty extensively landscaped project. We're planning a number of amenities and activities over the site for the elderly. We have a number of outside courtyards where the elderly can congregate, watch activity. We're planning a period-styled garden, a pond, a summer house, garden plots, game lawns, etc. I regard this project as a low-impact project. Of the 30-acre site, we're proposing about 2.3 acres of impervious land. During construction, we'll disturb about 7 acres, I believe, which would include the impervious and the revegetated area. Ultimately, we have about a 76% undisturbed area on the site, which would be natural habitat remaining. One issue I'd like to discuss with the board tonight is a parking issue. The ordinance requires one space per dwelling unit. Through my experience and actual demand by tenants in previous projects that I've worked on, the rate is about 0.65 to 0.75 parking spaces per dwelling unit. Comfort to the board, what we propose to do is take the additional spaces that would make up the net of one space per dwelling unit, build the gravel base, but loam and seed over it so that we could have a green lawn, and agree to pave those spaces should it become necessary to have them. With that overview on the site, I'd like I'd like to turn it over to Will Pogar to talk about the architecture for a minute.
I'm William Pogar, the architectural project manager for Gar & Associates. And we've worked with First Atlantic to plan this project as what we hope will be viewed by you as top-notch. We would like to put a lot of emphasis on detail, both for the residents and for the townspeople, so that they can take pride in this. We realize that it's in an important location in town. We would favor using indigenous materials, cedar shingles, stone, perhaps a stone veneer at the base. We would like to do a lot in the way of dormers and exterior decks and detail work so that it reduces the scale of the project, both, again, for the residents, so that they can identify this as a home. And we feel that the style of the project would be compatible with a lot of architecture that you currently find in Cape Elizabeth.
While you're talking, do you suppose you could take this drawing and turn it around so that either the camera can focus on it, and certainly so that the people in the audience can, as you're talking about some of the architectural...
Is it glare?
That way, as you're expressing some of the architectural features, there are some people that can...
Frank talked about the approach to the project, and we he's devised a long sweeping drive. We are also, for the residents, offering covered parking spaces. And the covered parking, hopefully this whole scheme will be viewed as perhaps a large inn, or and the covered parking as perhaps a stable or some outbuilding, trying to reduce the institutional nature of the project. We certainly hope to avoid that.
That the end of that parking structure is visible here. I don't know if you can see it. So we're developing a courtyard and a portico chair for people.
If you could continue expressing it to the board, and the only reason for suggesting you turn that around was so that the camera could focus on it.
Well, I think, as Frank said, we've balanced the building into the site, reducing a full story on at the rear of the building, which diminishes the impact, and the building is turned towards the homes that are adjacent to it. And we've discussed also with Ernie McVane and Steve Butler the issue of building height, and the building falls under the guidelines of BOCA, the allowable height for BOCA for this particular classification. I don't know if there are any questions that I can answer for you. I'd be happy to.
Could you explain what BOCA is for the...
BOCA is the local building code that you have adopted here in town. Building Officials Conference of America, Basic Building Guidelines.
Okay, we will be through a fairly extensive process of going back and forth and asking questions. I would propose that the planning board meet in a workshop session on this to spend a good quality time and not be encumbered by other items on an agenda. And I'm sure there'll be lots of questions that come up. We might deal with some of the quick ones. Dan, if that's the end of the presentation this evening.
Yes, I believe it is. I would welcome to have the opportunity to meet with the board in a workshop.
Okay. I would propose that we devote our May workshop to this issue. It's probably the most extensive project that we will review in this community as a single building and a single use, and its impacts have got to be, we must spend a lot of time on the potential impacts. Our May workshop session is
May 1st.
May 1st. Okay. Which is 2 weeks away on a Tuesday evening, and we'll devote the entire session, other than a briefing that Steve is going to give us on our wetlands ordinance that the council has adopted and will be effective shortly, to this as an issue. The public is welcome at that as well, and we will have a free forum discussion about the issues that are before us and your presentation as well. Very good presentation this evening. I'd ask the planning board members if May 1st is okay for our workshop, and that we spend our time during that workshop on First Atlantic's proposal. Jerry.
I would ask the board, is this concept that we at the board are discussing a similar concept to what was built in South Portland a number of years ago at 1700 Broadway? I noticed in your plans you have a central dining room and you have individual apartments with two single units, but you do have that kind of thing. Is that fairly close? So if some of the board members really wanted to take a look at the concept as it's being practiced today, they might get a feel for that over there.
I think probably the best project locally that looks most similar to this would be Ocean View and Selma.
I'm not necessarily thinking of, I'm just thinking of a concept.
The concept, yeah. The concept is similar to what has been done by Dick Carson. Physical layout will be different, but the program is similar. I'm not very familiar with the one you're talking about. I know that
it's got one and two bedroom apartment rooms with a single dining area. if the resident chooses to use it, some single common area. Some of the apartment units have a balcony.
That's correct. I think the difference between our project and that project is we would have more common area, more activity program, more space, so-called congregate use. Probably Ocean View and Falmouth, Huntington Common and Kenny Bunk.
Mm-hmm.
Schooner Estates and Damascotta. Those are probably the more upscale projects. I haven't been through the project that you referred to, but in Falmouth, that would be...
Let me add something to the discussion. 2 years ago, you took the board, I believe, on a tour of the Falmouth facility that
That's
was
correct.
Built by Dick Tarr. It was very enlightening as the board was then considering in concept your plan and the proposed zone change that we recommend as a planning board to the council, and council has subsequently adopted. It may be appropriate early in this process to, again, because of the number of new planning board members, to revisit the Falmouth facility if it's still possible, and just walk through and kick the tires and see what it looks like and feels like and how it operates.
I think that could be arranged, definitely.
That was a good tour.
Thank you.
Judith.
When I opened the packet up and looked at it, my jaw dropped. It's stunning. It really is. And when you just said you had proposed something at a much larger scale, I can't imagine. This is really, it's just beautiful.
Oh, thank you very much.
And it's really...
Now we'll get into the issue of whether it works.
Yeah.
No. Oh,
it's beautiful.
It will work.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Tom. Sorry. Mr. Chairman, you have passed around photographs showing the existing neighborhood and the field and so forth. From my perspective, and I'm not going to speak for the public this evening, but perhaps to better understand the implication of the massing of the building and the size of the building and the potential impact on that property and in relative to the existing residences, would it be possible to prepare photo montages or something for us to appreciate the building in context? Because ultimately, that's the way it will be evaluated.
Yeah, we could do that, definitely.
If you wanted to limit your work, perhaps a view from the driveway looking up at the building, and I don't know if there's any need to look at it from existing residences, but since you're saying in your packet that the orientation of the building reduces that impact, perhaps some way of understanding how that happens with views from abutting property or properties.
Sure, we could work on that for you.
Thank you.
Okay, other board members' comments before we move on to the next item on the agenda and invite you to our May 1st workshop session. Steve.
That'll just be at 7 o'clock for the applicant and for anybody else who'd like to attend.
Right here in town. Good. Thank you very much.
Thank
good
you
presentation.
Very much.
Looks like a good project, and we can't wait to get into it.
Great. Thanks.
We are running a little late this evening. Not unfamiliar territory to the board, however. The next item on the agenda is Sawyer Fields, a proposed four-lot subdivision by Daniel Stevens and Paul Letty. And this is a pre-application conference this evening.
Good evening.
The floor is yours.
My name is Paul Letty, and we're proposing a four-lot minor subdivision on Sawyer Road. We hope that the board sees that our application is complete, but as I understand it, the purpose for this meeting is to get any insight that the board can give us and give us a direction to go in.
Okay, the issue before us, as I understand it, we've lost our planner. So until he gets back, we'll just mumble for a while. My understanding is that this is a pre-application conference, that the submission of an application has not been submitted to the point where an application is deemed to be complete or incomplete, that the purpose of this evening is to look over your plans, give you our first thoughts and concerns and needs, and to elicit your thoughts on what you're prepared to do. Pending Steve's return to his seat, and I'll check that out with him when he gets back. You proposed purchasing the land and then having four driveways off Sawyer Road, and one of the things that we need to talk about with you is whether there are alternatives that might be more appropriate for the piece of land. Steve, while you were away, one of the issues was whether or not this is a pre-application conference or if this is an application completeness review.
Pre-application conference.
Yeah. So the issue is that there will be no formal vote tonight about completion or not completion. I can indicate to you that there would probably be incomplete because there are a number of issues that need to be addressed. Relating to where wetlands are and a number of issues. The design of the subdivision, if I might, just for a moment, really begs the question of whether or not it may be more appropriate to have one entrance off Sawyer Road and in some way the houses clustered or built on a portion of the property rather than just the road along the road with four individual driveway locations going off from it. And I have to refer to our comprehensive plan, which encourages the clustering of housing, the non-lineal nature of residential or commercial development in the community. Your subdivision is a very linearly oriented subdivision. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just a question of what is preferred by the town and what is preferred by you in your marketing. You have to propose the subdivision that the town will vote on, and as long as you meet all of the technical requirements of our ordinances, then an approval will be secured. At this point in the pre-application conference, though, we are talking about what you might like best and what the town might like best, so that before you go to the expense of producing a lot of plans, you've got some feedback and feel for how the planning board feels about a subdivision in this location. So with that, I would ask individual planning board members to express some of their thoughts on your subdivision. And maybe I can ask the first question. The subdivision has been before us before in terms of a pre-application conference. And we had information at that time that indicated that some of this site was wetlands. And you might address that and indicate to us where those wetlands are and how you propose to avoid those.
We do plan on addressing that. What we did show, seeing as this is a preliminary conference, the proposed lots will have envelopes where the buildings and subsurface disposal system will be. When we get more direction from you, we intend to address exactly where the wetlands are. But you, as you see, we're trying to show you where, if you're familiar with the site, that we're keeping the building structures away from the wetlands.
Where are the wetlands on the site?
If you were to go, let's say, maybe 300 or 400 feet back from the road, almost following the arc of the road, I believe that is
I think
where you find the wetlands.
Mr. Chairman, I think one of the things we're going to require is that a plan will show those wetlands.
Absolutely.
And they be mapped.
Absolutely.
I think that a verbal explanation is just not going to cut it, so to speak.
We understand that.
That would be one thing. And the other thing is I tend to agree with the chairman and his comments on this, that you're talking about four driveways off Sawyer Road. Each one of these is going to have to satisfy certain requirements in terms of site distances and all that. And if you can go back and take a look at a single entry, it simplifies it from that standpoint. It also makes a much better developer if you can do some clustering. So I would agree with that. But site distances are another question.
that that corner is, used to be much more difficult than it is now, but it's still a difficult corner, and we'll have to take a look at that.
In answer to that, we have obviously met with Stephen Butler, and he did mention to us cluster housing. What we've done is basically talked to the neighbors of that area and wanted to get some feedbacks from them, what they felt would be most appropriate for that area. I have, and I make copies for everybody if you're interested. I understand that, you know, it's too late to submit these, but I have copies for every member of the board of a very simple piece of paper here that shows that we have knocked on the doors in the neighborhood, and I've got six signatures that clearly state that they do not prefer cluster housing, but would rather see it more of a in line with what is existing. We're proposing 2 to 3 acre house lots, which are not small lots. The driveways would be 150 to 200 feet apart, and in some cases even greater than that. And they feel that that is more in line with their neighborhood and their property values and what they'd like to see. You know, we've given them the opportunity to go either way, and not one of them have gone to cluster housing. That is why we did not propose 2 plans, which was suggested by Stephen. And, you know, because it's so premature, we felt instead of, you know, going any farther than that, that we'd come to you as we are now and get some direction.
Appreciate that, and that's what we'll attempt to give you some feel for this evening. One of the things that the town does not do is administer its ordinance by petition. Those inputs are very important, and they're considered by a planning board and understood by a planning board, and it's appropriate that you have that. I would suggest that you submit that as part of your package the next time, so that it's in an appropriate period of time and it becomes a part of our package that we can evaluate with some good time spent on all of the information that's submitted. In spite of that, and understanding there is a lineal nature of the subdivision now, and understanding that clustering means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, there is a desire of the board to have a lot of public open space visually as well as functionally, and that one way that you achieve that is by somehow orienting your proposed structures in a way that visually a lot of open space is maintained. One way to do that would be to have your houses set further back in the field rather than right up on the road, and we understand the constraints that you're expressing, that that's a lot of wetlands back there, and it's tough to put the houses back there if they're in wetlands. So you've got some constraints on the site as well.
Well, the reason that what we've done is staggered them. We've put some houses back and some up near the house that's existing, just for the reason of views. You know, we have had a preliminary discussion with landscape architects, with two of the firms that we're working with, and felt that if we were going to go with 4 separate lots, that to stagger them in such a way that we proposed would maximize your views. The 2 houses on the outskirts, the 2 envelopes on the outskirts, are set back farther from the road, and they're also up against tree lines. So as you drive from either direction, they don't become visible until you're almost literally past them. And then the other 2 houses, which are generally up towards the road, kind of give the house that's in the middle of this field existing a little more conformity to the subdivision.
Other board members? Tom?
A couple of points. I'd like to see detailed topography of the site, 2-foot or 1-foot contours. The issue of clustering and public open space, I think rather than focusing on the clustering issue, I'd prefer to focus on traditional New England development patterns and resulting open space. You've almost started it here. You've got narrow, deep lots. I think if you look at traditional New England squares, those are normally houses that people wanted to maximize their frontage on the town square, and the lots went very deep, almost into infinity in some cases. So the configuration from that sense doesn't disturb me as much. Maybe there's an opportunity to narrow up the frontage and provide more open space at the more difficult portion of the property near the corner. However, that approach, that planning approach, comes very close to strip subdivision aesthetic as well. We could drive through Lincoln, Massachusetts, and other parts of Massachusetts and parts of Maine and find very nice rural areas where houses are located very close to the road, where they have stone walls, typically maple trees in the front yard with lilacs lining the driveway, white fences, all of those things. I don't think the resulting aesthetic is necessarily a function of setting the building back a long way from the road. To the contrary, you could have a nondescript house set way back, has nothing to do with the other houses. Every house is a cathedral to its own architect and so forth and so on. And then what you would have then, given this plan, is probably a subdivision that's not compatible either with the area or with the town in general. Again, whether you hook in with a single entrance drive and have a cul-de-sac, which again is somewhat of a non-traditional New England notion, it's more of a New Jersey subdivision. Someone remarked to me this afternoon that it's ironic that New Jersey is trying to look like Maine and Maine is trying to look like New Jersey in their development patterns. This is one of those situations where it's definitely an infill project. There's a real opportunity here to reestablish Sawyer Road and Pickett Street the way it once was, at least from the right-of-way back. And I would be looking to those sorts of overall amenities as part of your proposal in order to evaluate it more closely. I don't know if negotiation is the right word, but I think there are a number of ways of dealing with this, and I don't have any one set answer. I think a lot of it has to do with the creativity of the layout and where you propose to place the houses and generally the scale and massing of the houses and driveways and garages that you're proposing.
Okay. I'm not sure where you left that, Tom.
Well, I guess when I constantly hear the idea of clustering, and clustering is a notion based on fairly large parcels where you reap a lot of open space out of it. As you get to smaller parcels, what you end up with is a cul-de-sac without a lot of beneficial open space, and you end up with a higher density visually and not the benefit of the resulting open space. I'm trusting in this case that we're looking at, we don't know what we're looking at because we don't know what the net residential area is yet. I support the idea of clustering and as much open space as possible, but I'm not discounting the traditional New England development pattern of having houses lining streets in a traditional way with stone walls in the front, lilacs, maple trees, elm trees, whatever it was, whatever it is. Which is equally as strong in terms of providing open space. I think there's a real benefit to narrow and very deep lots and taking advantage of those narrow frontages and creating the open space perhaps as a parcel out to the edge of, as I described earlier. Okay. What I'm saying is I'm not totally opposed to the four driveway openings.
Okay. Jerry?
I would tend to agree with Tom in the fact that I'm not totally opposed to the four driveway openings. The one thing I might ask you to consider as you go through your process is your site distances on Sawyer Road and Pickett Street, especially in your first two lots where you may very well have a driveway coming directly out on Pickett Street, which could create a problem. And I guess I would suggest that maybe you work with Mr. Butler or Mr. Bray and trying to work through that, because you appear to have a large lot of acreage in your full four lots. You have aesthetically taken the view somewhat similar to Wainwright Circle, where the houses are placed further back in one lot, they're closer to the road, so that there is some aesthetic view there.
Steve.
Mr. Chairman, I guess I am almost totally opposed to four driveways coming directly onto Sawyer Road. I think that's probably the least attractive aspect of the preliminary drawing. I'm concerned safety-wise for the corner. This is not a village street. It's a moderately traveled access street. In essence, you have two lots on the corner, but altogether there are three because there's an existing home there. I foresee some site distance problems on those. I'd really prefer to see just one access street onto the site. I think all too often perhaps clustering brings to mind the condominiums when you mention clustering, and there's a whole realm of development possibilities other than condominiums when we consider clustering. I'd like to see you aim something away from the four direct access lots.
Other planning board comments? Okay, well, you have a divided view this evening from the planning board. Good luck. Sure.
Would the board like to see two or three, is that what you're looking for, plans that show cluster housing? And even in lieu of the fact that the general consensus in the neighborhood is we don't want that?
I would think that the planning board might be very interested in seeing a couple of different concepts bringing before it. You have one here. And it might be good to, in recognizing that this is a diverse group, as the neighborhood will be down there, about what the planning board might like to see. The final and end result is what you want to build, and as long as it meets the ordinance requirements of the town, then this board will vote on the technical merits of that, no matter how it's divided and how it might like to see that land become developed. But I think you've gotten some valuable input tonight that there is both a traditional view towards land development and a non-traditional view of land development in terms of how to maximize land values and open space and visual resources. To the extent that you can marry all of the comments tonight together, you'll be a magician. But I'm sure that it can be done, and I'm sure you'll find that this board will be reviewing your subdivision proposal in line with the ordinance requirements of the town of Cape Elizabeth. I would think that it would be appropriate for you to consider a couple of alternatives. Let me comment on one of those this evening. As I started this off, I was not proposing a traditional cul-de-sac type of development where you have your circle at the end with four houses located at the end of that. I think that there are some opportunities that are raised by the site. You have addressed one of those opportunities in a way that at least has some support on the planning board. How you marry all of the comments here tonight and reduce the number of driveway openings, perhaps, to less than four by sharing driveways or however that might be done. I do hear that a stone wall would be nice. I don't think you have any there.
There is a stone wall existing.
Lilacs are easy to transplant. We might like to see some of those ideas as well.
Well, there are some existing trees that are not in the way of anything. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. really what we proposed is the simplest and most uniform to the neighborhood type of subdivision that has the least amount of impact and is welcomed by literally all the neighbors that mm-hmm. That live in that general area.
To the issue of all of the standards of the subdivision, of course they will be maintained, and we would expect to see Tom mention the elevations and topography of the site. Of course, that would be one of the issues that would have to be submitted, and there are numerous others that you'll be having on your site plan, I'm sure. With that, any other planning board comments? Do you have any comments back at us?
No, except that this is we've gotten enough information, I think, to come back with some more ideas.
Good.
And,
go from there. Good. We will see you in May.
Thank you very much.
All right. The next item on the agenda is Cape Elizabeth School Department temporary four classroom addition to the middle school. Are there representatives from the school department? Good evening and welcome.
Mr. Chairman, Darrell Pelletier, Superintendent of Schools. We're here this evening because our student population defies our projections. And we're asking permission to erect at the middle school site a four-classroom portable. If I may, I'd like to give you our latest enrollment. Since September, we've added some 74 new students to the elementary K-5 population. And that has been primarily on grades 3, 4, and 5, where there was a bulge that was causing our class sizes to be quite high. So tonight we're asking that we are able to erect a 4-classroom portable at the middle school site, and our architect is here to explain where it would go and how large it would be. Mr. Armitage.
Thank you.
Copy of the revised. There were a couple of questions that Mr. Butler had with regards to some buildings that were missing. I believe it was the parking, the bus garage, on the original drawing that was submitted.
Bob, just before you start, perhaps we should point out to the planning board members that the only thing that was allowed to come before the planning board the night of the meeting. Data and material from internal to the town, and certainly this is, so we have the data before us this evening. Thank you.
Okay, my sheet number one is to show the basic middle school site as well as a location plan. The proposed addition is marked here in red, which will be at the rear of the 7th and 8th grade classroom building. If you look at sheet number two, that's basically a large-scale site plan at an inch to 40. Again, you can see the proposed addition, which is a 60 by 64 classroom addition to the rear of the 7th and 8th grade classroom building. The bus garage is here. One of the concerns that was requested was access, and we did a on-site inspection with the chief of the fire department, and we're proposing to put a gravel bed in here, which will be between the existing tennis court and a temporary building at the rear of the industrial arts, and that will go to Woodside High School and then swing down between some tree line here and then come out between the bus garage and the 7th and 8th grade classroom building. Yes, I think it's 16 feet here, and the fire chief would like to have access here. Actually, there's room enough to come around this way. There's a fence off from here, and he would prefer to keep this as roughly, that's a minimum width, but the problem, the concern that we have here is the students, public getting down into where the track is, and then so this is strictly designed as a fire lane. Sheet number three is an elevation of the addition, and the plan view over here, which is the end of the existing 7th and 8th grade classroom building. What we're proposing to do is to add a 60 by 60 addition here, and for those of you who are familiar with that building, there's an offset at the rear, and so we're going to close that offset in and make a lobby vestibule area, and there is some alteration work in that area. We're going to close off part of the stairwell so that the stairwell will meet the fire code and exit directly to the exterior so that it won't come back into the classroom building. And that was done to meet the fire marshal's request. Another question was the services. So we added another sheet to the drawings. You'll notice it's a S5, which is a drawing of the original site with the site utilities shown, which was done by John Stevens in 1960, which was for the construction of the